Today, we're back in Galesburg, Illinois. Last time we were here, we saw some crazy Dash 9s, the Golden Swoosh, and plenty of fallen flags. If you would like to see that video, the link's in the description. But the future is now, old man. So this go-round, we're going to see more oddballs, more fallen flags, and even some heritage units. So let's get right into it. From the 4th Street Bridge, we catch LCHI 105 getting ready to hook up to its cars. And I must say, this has to be one of the greatest lashups I've ever seen. It looks like something out of a video game. We've got two Santa Fe warbonnets, a B40-8W leader, and the only BNSF Smurf currently in service. Just like 686 and 644 from the last video, these two warbonnets are undergoing trial runs to make sure they're mechanically sound for hump service. And as for 2042, that's one of the rarest locomotives BNSF has to offer. Only 10 of these blue Jeeps were bought by BNSF in the late 2000s. Previously, all the engines were EMD leaser units, which is how they got their blue paint. Because BNSF has about 8,000 locomotives to look after, and doesn't care much about looks anyways, they just patched the old EMD logos and slapped on some BNSF decals, creating the Smurfs. Over the years, most of these Smurfs were repainted, and the few remaining ones that kept their original colors were put up in deadlines. After all, many of the 10 original Jeeps are around 50 years old. But for whatever reason, BNSF decided to take 2042 out of storage, and now it works as local power in the Chicago area. What's really neat is that none of these locomotives have had an oil change in almost 10 years. When you have anywhere from 250 to 400 gallons of oil in your engine, it takes a heck of a long time to dirty it all. On top of that, locomotives kind of change their own oil. Something somewhere on these giant machines is always going to be leaking. There's just too many seals and connections for everything to go right all the time. Plus, the engine burns a little bit of oil with each stroke. So every 90 days when a locomotive has to go into the shop for FRA mandated maintenance, workers just change the filters, check the oil, and top it off if necessary. Which means, as an engine slowly depletes itself of oil, workers slowly fill it back up, diluting the old lubricant and keeping the engine running fine. Strangely, after the locomotives were coupled up, the crew tied down the train and deboarded, meaning this is the last we're going to see of these engines in motion. When locomotives are being moved around the yard, you don't always need an engineer. Lots of times, it's a conductor who's engineer certified that's operating the train. A couple weeks later, we catch LCHI 104 running light on the Ottumwa sub, with an ABA consist straight out of the early 2000s. The cabless locomotive in the middle is 334, Galesburg's resident GP60B. I'm not sure if this train has just finished switching industry or if it's simply running light on its way back from Chicago. But nonetheless, it's on the move and we gotta catch it. GP60s as a whole were quite an interesting locomotive model. They were the last Jeeps ever made, with the final one rolling off the production line in 1994. And they're some of the strongest four-axle locomotives out there, with each traction motor making 950 horses. Interestingly, the GP70 was proposed, but it wasn't really necessary. There were and still are thousands and thousands of EMD Jeeps that worked perfectly fine, and railroads at the time were starting to move away from four-axle road power. So when EMD announced plans for the GP70, no one really cared.
We have to work very, very hard to keep it that low.
On the Atchison, Topeka, and the Santa Fe.
Over on the Southern Transcon, we catch a westbound Priority Z train. Strangely, these things work like pizza delivery. If a Z train doesn't arrive at its destination within a certain amount of time, then that train's customers pay nothing in shipping fees. This is why Z's take priority over everything else on the rails, because millions of dollars is at stake every time one of these departs an intermodal facility. Z trains are identifiable by their power and cargo. 99% of the time, there will be at least three locomotives on the head end, and the cargo almost always includes piggyback trailers and containers from UPS and FedEx, with refrigerated goods also being a common sight. Railroads alone handle 40% of UPS's freight and about 10% of FedEx's. By using rail transport, both companies save boatloads of money, because they don't have to pay hundreds more truck drivers to move their goods. All the while, railroads get a steady stream of business, and your package arrives quicker. It's a win cubed. A few miles east of town, we catch a pair of high-balling Jeeps. The reason blue bonnets look so much better than war bonnets, despite being much older, is largely due to the properties of color and light. In short, red has an exceptionally long wavelength, meaning it's going to absorb lots of the high-energy sunlight it comes in contact with, which only expedites the degradation of the paint molecules. Yellow also has a sizable wavelength, but in the case of a blue bonnet, it's quite light in color, so a lot of light is reflected, aiding in its longevity. And then there's blue. For light in the visible spectrum, blue has an incredibly short wavelength. Therefore, many of the harmful UV rays and other forms of electromagnetic energy it comes into contact with simply bounces off, keeping the paint in fantastic condition for decades. Back in town, we catch yet another unreal lashup, which really just speaks for itself. That was one of the last regular mainline runs 674 and 673 ever made. These days, they too are stricken to hump work. For the last moving train of this video, we head south to a little town called Abington, home of the tallest totem pole east of the Rocky Mountains, and a geometry train with a warbonnet leader. Right now, it's not permitted to go, because the southbound grainers already lined through out of Galesburg. The lone passenger car this warbonnet's pulling is equipped with an arsenal of lasers, cameras, radar equipment, and defect recognition technology that allows this rolling robot to take photos like this and identify almost any defects you could think of. After data has been collected, it's sent to BNSF's engineering department within a few minutes. The technology on these cars allows them to see cracks in the rail as small as a 16th of an inch, as well as internal cracks humans normally couldn't identify, all while barreling down the tracks at 70 miles an hour. But it's not just cracks these things look out for. They also measure the ballast, the rail joints, track curvature, wear and tear, and still much more. BNSF only has about four of these automated geo cars, so if you ever get the opportunity to see one, consider yourself very lucky. A few hours later, the grainer finally came. While these hoppers are unloaded simply by gravity, many other covered hoppers are unloaded with the help of compressed air. Some, such as air slide hoppers, have a porous lining on their walls, which low-pressure air passes through during unloading. This air fluidizes the cargo, helping it to flow easily out the bottom, while the air escapes out the top. Other hoppers, such as the pressure differential type, not only fluidize their cargo from the bottom, but also actively force it out, as a car body itself is meant to hold about 3 psi of air pressure. Once the main line was clear, dispatch gave the go-ahead to one of the most technologically advanced trains on the rails.
And smoke, the heaters broke, the door just flew away. I light a match to see the dash, and then I start to pray. The frame is bent, the muffler went, the radio, it's okay.
Now, we head back to the yard, where we once again see some of the rarest locomotives on BNSF's roster. The C-40-8Ws were retired during the mid-2010s due to old age. Almost all of them were stockpiled in the well-known Galveston deadline, though some continued to see life on Canadian National. There's two main reasons as to why BNSF has held on to these for almost a decade. Firstly, it's tricky to find a buyer who can not only store, but also process this much bulk material. Secondly, since the railroad still actively maintains a small fleet of Dash 8s, these engines made fantastic parts banks for hard-to-find or discontinued components. Some of these engines, such as 898, didn't look completely terrible, but others, such as 876, should have been scrapped a long, long time ago. During this machine's last year of service, its prime mover caught fire and was never repaired. This is where the modular air intake manifold should be. Instead, it's completely melted off, along with a large portion of the common rail fuel system and a few valve covers. With this clear view of the prime mover, we can also see 7 out of the 16 power assemblies, 2 arterial water passages, 1 intake air intercooler, 1 outlet pipe on the turbo, the main water reservoir, along with some other coolant pipes, and the dipstick. All of these locomotives are already at Larry's Truck and Electric in Lordstown, Ohio, and I'm sure the scrapping process has already begun, so I consider it a real treat that we were able to see this vintage power before it's gone for good. We also see the C-40-8W's standard cab counterpart in the form of an ex-Conrail C-40-8. With no visible reporting marks, it's hard to tell what's going to happen to this engine. It could be going to Albia, Iowa or Erie, Pennsylvania for refurbishment. It could also be going to the coast for export, or it could be headed to the scrapyard. Next up, we see a Great Northern SDP-40 passenger locomotive on its way back from the paint booth in Albia, Iowa. This engine is one of the prized possessions of the Minnesota Transportation Museum. Previously, 325 wore BN's classic Cascade Green, but these are the colors it would have worn back when it was brand new in 1966. Unlike many museum pieces, 325 is fully functional and frequently pulls excursion trains around Wisconsin and Minnesota. The logo decal was added after it arrived at the museum. BNSF actually owns the rights to Great Northern and frequently uses the old GN reporting marks on laid-up locomotives, so 325's logo was left off to avoid possible confusion or legal issues. Speaking of pristine paint from the past, we also see Canadian National's one and only Wisconsin Central Heritage Unit, coupled to an exceedingly rare BC Blueberry, which we discussed in the previous video. Canadian National released their fleet of 5 Heritage Units back in 2020 to celebrate the 25th anniversary of the railroad becoming a publicly traded company. The extinct railroad this Jeebo's honoring is actually not the original Wisconsin Central. WC as we know it today was founded in 1987, shortly after the Milwaukee Road went under, and was bought by CN in 2001. But the first Wisconsin Central Railroad was founded over 100 years prior in the early 1870s. The line aided greatly in settling the northern half of its namesake state, then saw massive financial problems leading to bankruptcy around the turn of the 20th century, before being merged into the Sioux Line in 1961. The next heritage unit we see is Norfolk Southern 8101, the Central of Georgia. If you haven't seen already, Norfolk Southern is slowly but surely rebuilding and repainting their fleet of heritage units, starting with the Aces, and they look just as good as the day they debuted back in 2012. So far, no Jeebos have gotten this treatment, but they will eventually. I wonder, once the original 20 heritage units reach the end of their service life, will NS continue to use these one-of-a-kind paint jobs on newer locomotive models and keep the fleet alive, or will they let these historic colors die out one by one? Just south of the shops on the service track, we see some aforementioned hump power waiting to be topped off with sand and fuel. For Galesburg's hump sets, the middle locomotive is actually classified as the leader. The three SD40-2Bs that work the hump are the only ones in existence. To my knowledge, none of them came this way from the factory. All three were rebuilt as cabless units during the 1980s after being involved in wrecks. They were used as road power until the early 2000s, but for the past 20 years, they've been stationed in Galesburg and don't show any signs of leaving or being retired. With thousands and thousands of rail cars in this yard, rare rolling stock can be found quite readily, like this Chessie Hopper. I would love to know how many of these are left. Out of the tens of thousands of rail cars I've seen, this is the only Chessie System 1 I've come across. Before leaving, we also see a Grey Ghost AC-44 shoving back into mechanical, and there's really nothing special other than the paint. Rough estimates say that only about 20 of these remain today. And for the final catch of the day, we see BNSF 1063, one of the 4 H1 oddballs. This Dash 9's mixed match logos are the result of a collision it was involved in back in 2016. After repairs were made and the paint was ready to be applied, workers were forced to use a modern swoosh logo, as the old wagon wheel that should be on the nose had long been discontinued. Also, it's got 2 model decals. I guess a railroad really doesn't want you forgetting this is a Dash 9. Thanks for watching. If y'all enjoyed this video, consider checking out some other ones of mine. Also, maybe pass yourself by the merch shop. Anyways, till next time.